everyone, Anna here with the Coding Guild. Today we are going to discuss the 2021 EM changes in general, how to level based on time only, and our new prolonged services codes. Gist of the changes for this year is that while in 2020 we applied the same rules for all EM services with regards to leveling and the usage of time, from 2021 the office and other outpatient visit codes are singled out and given their own rules. Due to this change, a lot of concepts had to be redefined by the AMA, what caused kind of a schism in the guidelines. From 2021, we have three sets of rules. One for all EM services. These are common rules applicable to all EM codes, such as the concept of new and established patients. We have a separate set of rules only for office visit and other outpatient services. And then we have a third group of rules for all other non-office or other outpatient services, such as emergency visits, inpatient visits, skilled nursing facility visits, etc. Going forward, it is very important to understand this difference because we have to recognize when we need one set of guidelines over the other. Because different guidelines apply to different places of service and code ranges, we will have to pay very close attention where the patient is being seen and what code range is being used, because it can break or make our coding. For most EM visits, we will still use the old rules where history, exam, and the medical decision-making component will decide the level of service, and it is only the office and other outpatient services and that code range where we need the new guidelines. One thing to emphasize here is that the office and other outpatient visit code range is sometimes used for other than office visits. Notice the full descriptor of these codes, office or other outpatient services. Now, these other outpatient services can be something simple like a tent or other temporary setup. It could be an outpatient clinic visit, an urgent care center visit, but they can also be something trickier like a consult for a Medicare patient or a subsequent visit in an observation unit on the same day of service, again for a Medicare patient. This latter one with observation is especially awkward because the CPT book explicitly directs the coder to outpatient consult codes or subsequent observation codes. Because the new guidelines follow the code range, really, and not the title of these codes, from now on we always have to ask ourselves, how does my payer want me to code for this service? Which code range do they want me to use for this? The answer to this question is very important because it will decide which guidelines we have to use. Do we have to start counting elements or do we just use the new guidelines? For Medicare, most of the answers regarding EM coding can be found in the Internet-only manual, Chapter 12. So what's new for 2021? Going forward, we are allowed to use either time or medical decision-making alone to level a service. We will not need the history and exam elements anymore. Just like before, we are allowed to use whichever method is more beneficial to the provider. And last but not least, 99201 got deleted. Let's see some details on how we are to level based on time. As mentioned, from now on, time can be a deciding factor on its own. The requirement that counseling and coordination of care dominates the visit is no more. We don't have to pay attention to that anymore for office and other outpatient visits. New this year that we have exact time ranges for every visit instead of the average duration. This means that there is no more midpoints, averages, rounding up, and none of that ambiguity. We can code visits based on the exact minutes the provider gives us. Notice that the lowest duration we must reach if we want to level based on time is 15 and 10 minutes. If our visit is shorter than that, we will have to default back to leveling the service based on medical decision making only. And very importantly, and this is the biggest change we have, time from now on can be credited for pre- and post-visit activities as well. We are not restricted to the face-to-face time the provider spends with the patient. And this is great news because a lot of providers felt before that their additional work of charting, coordination of care, and so on didn't get paid for. What exactly can we count towards time? According to the CPT book, the followings are allowed to be accounted for: preparing to see the patient, obtaining and reviewing history, performing the visit itself, counseling and education, ordering medications, tests or procedures, referring and communicating with other healthcare provider, charting, independently interpreting results and communicating said results to the patient or family or caregiver, and last, care coordination. Now, there is some fine print to all of this. All activities counted towards time must be performed on the same date of service of the office or other outpatient visit. If care-related work spills over to other dates of service, those will have to get paid with separate dedicated codes, but they cannot be factored into this EM level. 2. Only time spent by the physician or other qualified healthcare professional qualifies. If an activity is performed by clinical staff, that cannot be used towards leveling. Also important to note here that not all provider time will count either. If the performed task does not need professional judgment and involvement, its duration cannot be counted towards the visit. For example, if the provider spends 35 minutes on the phone waiting for the radiology department to pick up, that's not going to count. We also have these notations, if not separately reported. These are here to prevent double dipping. If a provider orders or performs a procedure from which he or she benefits financially in any way, that cannot be counted towards the time when leveling the EM service. For instance, if the provider reports a code for an interprofessional conference or a telephone consult or ongoing care management, then the time spent on those activities will be paid for by their own code and cannot be factored into the office visit. When leveling based on time, there is only so much we can work with before the time will max out. And for these situations, we have two new prolonged services codes. One of them, 99417, was created by the AMA, while the other, G2212, was established by CMS. These codes are almost identical in their use. Both of them describe prolonged services with or without direct patient contact. Both must be performed by the physician or other qualified healthcare professional. Both of them are used only on the same day of service when the office or other outpatient visit takes place. Both are used to report an additional 15 minutes of prolonged service time. None of them are coded if the prolonged time is less than 15 minutes. Remember that we did away with midpoints and threshold and all that. It has to be at least 15 minutes. Both of these codes can only be added to the highest level of service, 99205 or 99215. And finally, both of them can be used only if the base code was selected based on time and not medical decision making. Here is the same information in a more coder-friendly format. If you can answer yes to all of these questions on the checklist, then you are good to use 99417 or G2212 based on payer. Before we look at documentation requirements for time, let's quickly address why we have two new codes for prolonged services when they are so very similar. It happened this way because although CMS agreed with the AMA on the proposed time ranges for the visits themselves, they disagreed with them on how to measure and bill for prolonged services. CMS and the AMA agreed that 99205 shall describe a visit lasting 60 to 74 minutes. Now CMS, and we will start with them because their method is a little bit more logical, said that prolonged service is something that happens in addition to the maximum visit time, something that goes above and beyond the norm. For them, prolonged service means that the provider spends the maximum allowed visit time, 74 minutes, then the provider puts in some additional effort, goes above and beyond the norm, and only then can they start charging for prolonged services for every additional 15 minutes. Now, the AMA wanted to be much more lenient, and this is what we have in the CPT book as well. For them, prolonged time and prolonged service starts at the minimum designated visit time, in our case this is 60 minutes, then runs concurrently with the visit until the provider hits the upper limit of this code, 74 minutes, and if they go just 1 minute beyond that, then that's already a prolonged code. As we can see, there is a huge difference in how the AMA and CMS wanted to count prolonged services time, and this is the reason they decided to just part ways and have two separate codes. So how exactly is the provider expected to document his or her time spent on the visit? The AMA and CMS didn't set strict guidelines on documentation, and that was on purpose because the whole point of this EM rule overhaul was to help the providers minimize documentation and move forward with the patients over paperwork initiative. With that said, there are some best practices. Itemized clock time is not expected from the physicians. They don't have to document every single activity and how much time they spent on it, because that would be incredibly burdensome. So expecting them to say something like, I started the visit at 8:02, finished at 8:13, documented in the EHR between 8:16 and 8:19, etc. This is too much. This would actually set them back more than what they had before. If they could document their block time, that would be more than enough. They can say something like, I spent 42 minutes with this patient today, I reviewed her previous lab results, etc., etc. The important thing here is to show the work that the provider performed. Alternatively, instead of just stating the minutes, some providers might want to use clock time here and involve the total care time spent with the patient in a format like this. I saw Ms. Taylor from 8:10 to 8:37, during which time the followings were performed. Then they can list all their activities. Again, they don't have to assign separate minutes to every activity. Whichever method the provider chooses, it's very important that the documentation should establish medical necessity for the time spent, and it should be realistic. Providers should take care not to document 16 hours worth of visits for every single day if they are only working 9 or 10 hours, because that might cause problems. In summary, in 2020, time was a contributory factor and could be used on its own only if more than 50% of the visit was dedicated to counseling or coordination of care. Now the time itself can determine the level of service. It has become a required element. Back in 2020, we only had average minutes, and we had rules and midpoints and all of that. But in 2021, we have well-defined exact ranges. Additionally, we have two new codes for prolonged services, 99417 and G2212. The main pitfalls to look out for when leveling based on time: beware of separately reported services, because the provider cannot get paid twice for the same service. Also, make sure that you are only counting time for all the care activities that were performed on the same date of service when the office visit or other outpatient service took place. Past achievements and the promises of the future are not covered by these new guidelines. That's all we had for today. I hope it was helpful. Please stay tuned for part 2, where we discuss the medical decision making and some miscellaneous items for 2021. Don't forget to attempt our free quizzes at the website thecodingguild.com. Thank you again. I will see you soon in our next video.